This CoinWeek Podcast is brought to you by PCGS. Get instant access to industry-leading coin expertise with PCGS Education Series, a collection of easy-to-follow videos designed to walk you through the elements of coin grading. All you have to do is sign up for a free account on pcgs.com/education to get started. Gorge Selgin is a senior fellow and director for the Center of Monetary and Financial Alternatives at the Cato Institute, and Professor Emeritus of Economics at the University of Georgia. A co-founder of the Modern Free Banking School, Selgin is an economic researcher and theorist whose work on money and regulation touches upon matters of coinage, specie, and government regulation of money and banks. He joins me in this episode of the CoinWeek Podcast to talk about the gold standard, free silver, and America's busted banking system. Hi, Gorge. Thanks for joining me on the CoinWeek Podcast.
Oh, thank you, Charles. It's a pleasure.
One of the things I think coin collectors are generally interested in, but do not understand at the level that you would or an economist would, is the gold standard. What exactly was the gold standard, and how was it implemented in the United States?
Oh, actually, those aren't simple questions, so I'm happy to answer them, and I think there's a lot of misconceptions around about them. The gold standard has actually meant rather different things at different times, in general, but specifically within U.S. history. What it originally meant in general was simply a system where the ultimate form of money consisted of gold coins themselves and some bullion for larger transactions, and where every other kind of money in use, particularly paper notes issued by banks, consisted of IOUs. That is, these were representatives of gold that were redeemable in gold, or they were supposed to be. And of course, if a bank didn't redeem its IOUs, paper or otherwise, why it was declared to have failed and it was closed. So that's what the gold standard meant. The meaning changed in a very fundamental way as governments became more and more involved in issuing paper currency. And at some point when they took it over completely, instead of it being a contractual matter that the paper currency represented so many ounces of gold, it changed to being a policy matter. That is, it was a policy of governments and their agents, including central banks, to uphold what now was the gold standard by honoring this value of their currencies. Why does it matter whether it's contract or policy? It matters a great deal because, as I mentioned before, if it was a matter of contract, a bank that dishonored it was shut down. It had defaulted. Whereas with central banks, once they got in charge, well, as we now know, of course, they could stop paying gold with impunity. They could even announce a devaluation, and they would stay in business. They would remain going businesses. So that's one of the important changes in the meaning of the gold standard that happened historically that people often overlook. So that's part of the question, what was the gold standard and how, and part of why there's more than one answer. The other thing, specifically referring to the United States, that I want to emphasize is that we have not actually been on a gold standard. That is, we were not on a gold standard for all that long in the United States. Officially, in fact, the United States did not have a gold standard in the strict sense until 1900. Unofficially, we had a gold standard between 1879 and the 1930s, but officially we didn't go on a gold standard till 1900. And the reason for that is that officially we were on a bimetallic standard, so-called, before 1900, meaning that the dollar was defined both in terms of gold and in terms of silver until that date. What happened, though, is after the great gold discoveries the 1840s, gold became less valuable than it had been relative to silver. Consequently, given the bimetallic policies in place, gold was officially overvalued at the mint, and that meant that people brought gold to the mint to have it coined, but they didn't bring silver anymore because it was legally undervalued. So the only actual coins being produced, and again, this is after 1879, because between 1863 and 1879, we were on the greenback standard because the Civil War had caused a suspension of gold payments. But anyway, once we resumed in 1879, only gold came to the U.S. Mint to be coined. And effectively, but not still officially, we were on a gold standard. Officially, again, we got on a gold standard in 1900. In the 1930s, of course, the Fed stopped converting dollars into gold. So domestically, we went off the gold standard. Yet even then, we didn't quite have the gold standard go away completely, because the Fed continued afterwards to convert dollars into gold for foreign central banks, albeit at a devalued rate for the dollar. And that continued, that arrangement in one form or another continued until 1971, when the last link to the gold, between gold and the dollar, was broken by Nixon's closing of the so-called gold window. So that, there in a nutshell is the story about the gold standard. If I could just add one more detail, Charles, it's also the case that most countries went off the gold standard in World War I. So another big change I should mention is that whereas before World War I, our U.S. gold standard was part of an international gold standard, also called the classical gold standard, during and after World War I, things were no longer ever the same. And although some countries did resume gold payments after World War I that had suspended them during the war, we never quite recreated the same kind of gold standard arrangement internationally that we had before the war.
I'm going to put forward a premise or understanding, and you can either corroborate this or disabuse me of these notions. The first is that, and I'm going to go back to the big fight between the gold bugs and the silverites that dominated American politics for several decades at the end of the 19th and the beginning of the 20th century. It seems to me that one of the arguments that went back and forth was that silver was an inflationary currency and gold was a deflationary currency. But I wonder, in a contemporary context, do we understand today inflation and deflation as these conditions would have manifested in an economy backed by metal?
Things haven't changed so much in the sense of we can understand what that debate was all about in terms of our modern understanding of the terms inflation and deflation, because it boiled down, I think, to this: that under the gold standard, which was of course the actual standard unofficially, but the actual standard when these debates were raging, it's true that prices were tending to fall. So we had deflation in the same sense that we understand that notion today. Prices were falling at a fairly gentle rate overall. However, in some sectors, and agriculture was one of them, they were falling more rapidly, and this is why the farmers particularly perceived the gold standard as something disadvantageous to them, and that was informing the populist move sentiments in favor not only of making the silver standard function again, and I'll explain in a moment exactly in what sense silver had been already officially demonetized, but they not only were arguing for restoration of a true silver standard, which they believed would result in less deflation, they were also, many of them, pleading for the government to issue more paper money in the form of those greenbacks it first issued in the Civil War. And again, they wanted more inflation, but it was in the same sense that we would think of it today. They wanted prices, if not to rise, to at least not fall as much, particularly in their sector of the economy, as was actually happening in the gold standard. The particular thing that incensed the silverites was what they famously called the crime of 1873. And the funny thing about the crime of 1873, so-called, is that nobody called it that, and hardly anybody even noticed it happened at the time, but it became the big issue around which the silverites rallied in the 1890s William Jennings Bryan as their representative. And what actually happened in 1873, as you might, you probably know, is that silver, as I said, had been legally undervalued at that time. And so, in fact, of course, we were on a greenback standard, so it didn't really matter. Nobody was bringing silver to the mint anyway. However, in that year, the mint struck silver dollars off the list of coins that it was willing to make. In other words, it had quietly demonetized silver, though nobody noticed it at the time. Then, in the 1890s, what happened was people realized that had that not been done, a decline in silver's market value by then meant that silver would have started coming back to the mint, only it didn't because they took it off the list, as it were. And that's when people said, wait a minute, this thing that happened quietly in 1873 was a crime because if it hadn't, we might be getting our silver standard back automatically now. And, of course, they pleaded for the government to, in fact, take steps to make that happen and lost.
So in this case, and if you're not a coin collector student of this topic, you're probably still probably well aware that in more recent years, the government tried to circulate a dollar coin and they were not accepted by the public and there was no demand for them. Partly because the $1 Federal Reserve notes and probably because people didn't want dollar coins jingling around in their pockets. So the Treasury is stocked full of golden dollar coins, which are not made of gold but are golden color. In 1878 and onward, the United States Mint, compelled by Congress because of the discovery of the Comstock Lode, a huge cache of underground silver, and with the direct influence of Western mining interests, struck hundreds of millions of silver dollar coins that nobody wanted. Due to the falling price of silver, these dollar coins were basically fiat money with a $1 face value and much less silver value. So in this example, like with the modern dollar coin, you have an instance where the government interfered with monetary policy and created a product that the market did not want.
Well, that's right. See, now I have to explain, because it sounds like we've had a contradiction, but we haven't. The mint was not open for the coining of silver bullion as it once had been before 1873. Otherwise, those Comstock discoveries would have led to people bringing bullion to the mint to strike full-bodied dollar coins, which would have been worth a dollar of silver. And that didn't happen, of course. What did happen was, as a kind of compromise or sop to the silver interests, the government itself bought silver and coined these coins you referred to on its own account, which it called dollars, but which in fact had a lot less than a dollar's worth of silver in them. And so they kind of resembled modern coins in that respect of being worth a lot more nominally than the value they represented. And what the government did in fact do was stockpile these coins. Now the point is that you didn't really have a monetary reform there. You had essentially a way to make the silver miners happy, the silver interests happy. But bear in mind, it didn't do much for the farmers, right? So as a genuine free coinage of silver would have done. And what's interesting about that story, which again made the miners happy, though not anybody else, is that's exactly what the U.S. Mint has done, not just in its most recent effort to recreate metallic dollar coins, but also in its earlier efforts to do the same, both of which involved an uncynical person would say two mistakes. A cynical person would say two devices designed to ensure that the coins would never circulate. The coins were too similar in size to quarters, and that was one point. The other is, of course, that the government never demonetized paper dollars, which the public tended to prefer anyway. So all of these dollar coins ended up piling up at the mint. But, of course, if the mining industries, this time not silver, but other less precious metal mining industries, if the idea was to help them, the policy worked like a charm. And I believe those really were the true intended beneficiaries of the recent dollar coinage attempts. They're also the main beneficiaries of the government's insistence on maintaining pennies as part of our currency, even though most of them just pile up on our dresser drawers or in our piggy banks instead of actually being used.
So we laid out the case of the silver dollars, the Morgan dollar period silver dollars. I wanted to talk to you a little bit about gold. There have been a number of gold booms in U.S. history. There was one in your old stomping grounds as a professor of economics at the University of Georgia, where we had the Dahlonega Mint, Charlotte Mint. They were created to coin gold that was extracted from lands that so happened to be occupied and lived on by Cherokee Indian tribes, until Andrew Jackson and others forced them to vacate the territory so that the gold could be mined and the land could be developed by Americans. There's also a much bigger deposit of gold that was discovered in 1848 and 49 in California. What we see economically develop in California is very interesting, is that it sort of plays against the idea of gold as deflationary. When gold was discovered, essentially everybody who goes to find their fortune prospecting for gold finds that the cost of anything that one would want would skyrocketed in California, because gold had become so plentiful that people were selling provisions, lodgings, companionship, and they're eager to take the gold out of the hands of the prospectors. So in that situation, you see an imbalance of the scarcity of the metal, its supposed value, and how it led to a very inflationary period of pricing. I'd argue that California is still somewhat affected by this inflationary element, as the real estate value and land in California and the cost of goods in the state remains out of alignment with the rest of the country.
Yes, yes. So two things are going on in California and in the country in the 1840s and 50s. First of all, bear in mind that gold became deflationary later on. At that time, the gold discoveries were, of course, not deflationary either in California or for the rest of the country. They weren't all that inflationary for the whole country, however. If you look at the statistics, you don't see much of an increase in prices all around. What you do see is that a previous bout of deflation comes to an end as a result of these discoveries, so they kind of make up for it. And that's not a coincidence. What happens is if the gold has been getting more valuable, the prospecting activity goes up. And in a sense, although the actual discovery at Sutter's Mill was itself fortuitous, people were looking, of course, and they were looking because the value of gold had risen. Anyway, in California itself, as you said, the inflation was much more considerable. That's actually a result, though, of two things. It's a result of the increase in the quantity of gold, of course, which, by the way, at first they don't know what to do with it except mint it locally, because they don't want to risk sending it all the way to the East Coast where the only official mints are. So you get all these cool private mints. I'm sure some of your listeners have collected some of the gold coins they produced, many of which were quite nice and even better in gold content than the official stuff at the time. Anyway, you have that, but you also have, of course, the tremendous influx of people coming into California, in part to prospect and look for gold, but also to take advantage of all the activity in mining to produce ancillary goods and services for the industry. And that is, of course, creating all kinds of booms in California that are independent of the quantity of gold. It's a a general increase in the demand for real estate, services, goods in California compared to the rest of the country, much like what's been happening more recently. So there's a greater money supply, but there's also, independent of that, what you might call a higher velocity of money in California because of all of the people going in there. And both together are contributing to an extraordinary demand for goods and services and land in that part of the country. You're right, it doesn't seem to have stopped.
I think about the allure of gold and how it drove European colonialism. Both the classic period of colonialism where, you know, the New World was discovered by Christopher Columbus, and Columbus was looking for gold here after he landed and discovered the indigenous people he encountered had it. The Spanish crown wanted gold extraction, which was the principal reason why they funded the expeditions. And also the second, the late 19th and early 20th century era of colonialism in Africa. It seems to me that gold and the allure and desire to have it has both had a mercantilist element for the countries extracting it and trading in it, and also high social costs for those on whose land this gold was discovered. How do we adapt our thinking about the possible reacceptance of a gold standard and not repeat these mistakes?
Well, I might surprise you and your listeners if I tell you I'm not one of those people who thinks we should, that our best bet is to go back to a gold standard. However, the plain truth is that if what you're worried about or what your concern is the amount of effort and cost and other consequences associated with a lot of gold mining activity, your best way of minimizing those, and this I can affirm with statistics all you like, the best way to have fewer resources going into gold is to have a gold standard, not primitive gold standard, but an advanced gold standard where banks are issuing good substitutes for gold. Because what that means is that people, at least for their monetary purposes, have all these close substitutes for gold. They're redeemable in gold. They're worth the same amount. They're more practical in circulation. And, of course, if everything's working well, they retain their value as well as gold itself. There's no such thing as a demand for gold itself as an inflation hedge in a gold standard situation, because plain old money will do. That is, the claims are redeemable. If you look at that, to be more direct about it, the amount of effort that goes into and the amount of adverse consequences associated with the mining of gold, social, environmental, or otherwise, are related to how high gold's market price is, that is, in real terms, in inflation-adjusted terms. Well, you can look at the record. Since we abandoned the gold standard, we've had, in general, a far higher real price of gold than we had before, and more effort going into those industries than before, and more adverse consequences. Of course, we don't have slavery anymore, and we don't have some of the other terrible consequences like driving Indians off their land, but we do have the environmental consequences and other bad stuff. That's been going on more than ever under our modern fiat money systems. And that's because in those systems, people have more reason to worry about the ordinary currency losing value over time and to seek gold as an alternative way to store value, as they do to a very considerable extent in certain countries abroad, like India. But as even central bankers do by being notorious gold hoarders, they're hedging against their own misconduct, as it were. So the actual truth of the matter is that a gold standard, at least historical sort of gold standards that we've had, where you have banks producing close substitutes that people mostly relied on, is a means for economizing on the demand for gold rather than something that tends to enhance that demand. So if you want to have less gold mining, by gosh, you need to be a gold bug. It's one of the sounder arguments for wanting to see a restoration of gold. Like I said, I think there are reasons, plenty of them, for not thinking that that's what we should look forward to or try to implement. and I don't speak for most libertarians, of course, when I say that, but that cost savings is not a reason for avoiding a gold standard. We would have less gold mining with a good gold standard, especially an international one, than we do now.
I'd like to get your thoughts on free banking, modern free banking, which I know that you're an advocate for in a minute. But first, you did bring up a curious phrase that I'd like to expound upon. Why is it that central banks, if they're producing fiat currency and running a global economy on it, why do they hoard gold, or as some people believe, manipulate gold prices? Why is it that they are such aggressive buyers and stockpilers of gold if they no longer believe in a gold standard or a gold monetary system?
I'm afraid, Charles, that you got me there. I don't think anybody really knows, and of course I can't get into the heads of the central bankers themselves, who have never really, as far as I know, they have never really individually or much less as a group explained why they persisted in holding gold in their portfolios and in some cases a lot of it. And I don't think, I cannot think personally of a good reason why they should do so as a matter of meeting their responsibilities. So I don't know the answer. I doubt they could give you a good answer, and that's all I can do on that one. I'm sorry.
I recall many years ago sitting in a high school civics class, and perhaps a very liberal teacher that I had at the time suggested that one of the reasons why the United States shouldn't drill for oil in Anwar was because if oil ran out elsewhere and wasn't available, there was a great national emergency or need for it that you would have these reserves in the stockpile. And perhaps that's a little simplistic, as it would take many years of construction and tremendous infrastructure to extract oil from such a remote and harsh climate. But I think about central banks hoarding gold, as you said earlier, as a safeguard against their own bad behavior. And it seems to me that if this country was in a period of great national emergency and needed support, goods, allies, or whatever you'd want to call it, and the money was collapsing or under threat. I remember during World War I that Germany was trying to collapse the Indian rupee to hurt Great Britain. So economic warfare is always a major part of warfare, at least with real gold reserves, is that you can, under duress, continue to buy friends and favors with it, at least for a while.
Well, the problem with that argument, though, and the reason why it's not analogous with stockpiling oil, is that the main cause of depreciation of any central bank's money is itself. It's true that there have been efforts to, by foreign governments, to replicate other central banks' monies or counterfeits and, you know, ruin them that way. There's economic warfare stories are out there, and there's truth to them. Don't get me wrong. However, nothing beats a central bank's own misconduct for ruining its currency, much as the Germans tried in World War II to ruin the British pound. Let's remember whose currency they ultimately ruined. It was their own, the Reichsmark. Boy, and they did a good job of that. They didn't have to fake them either. They just had to print too many of the real things. So, having gold, of course, for the rest of us is good protection against central banks' misconduct. But as far as central banks themselves are concerned, having gold speaks to their own, lack of confidence in their own abilities to maintain the currency's values more than anything else. And of course, if currencies depreciate, including their own, gold does tend to go up in value, so they would have a capital gain. As such, they would be acting as successful hedge funds. They wouldn't be acting as successful central banks doing what they're supposed to do.
So what brought about, in your opinion, the collapse of the gold standard as we know it? Why did it fall apart?
World War I, in a word. to elaborate, most of the countries that were on the gold standard at the outbreak of the war, of course, there were belligerents in the war, and they all got off the gold standard. You might say that, of course, the fear that they were going to get off forced them off, but in the end, it was a fiscal thing. They being up to gold standard allowed them to get engaged in fiscal and paper money finance to as part of their effort to pay for the war. And this is an old story with governments, money, and war. The U.S. Didn't go off completely, though it did limit gold shipments abroad. So you might say that internationally it had a semi-suspension of gold payments. Okay, so that ended the gold standard for the time being. However, what happened after the war is that in their efforts to try and return to the gold standard, the various governments tried to jury-rig things, because the most obvious way to restore the pre-war gold standard would have been to undo all the money creation that the belligerents took part in during the war, which would have meant deflating prices that had been increased dramatically in some cases during and immediately after the war, and then restoring the old gold values of their currencies. Well, that was a very, very difficult proposition. The other alternative was devaluation, that is to restore gold, their gold standards, but with different gold values of their currency. And that too had some repercussions, of course, for outstanding debts and so on. And for various other reasons besides that, some governments were reluctant to devalue or to devalue very much. Consequently, in an effort to avoid either too much deflation or more devaluation than they wanted, the governments in the 20s made a fateful decision, particularly the British government, but other governments were involved. They decided to try to restore the gold standard on the cheap, as it were, as a way of allowing themselves to not have to deflate that much or devalue, and making their existing gold holdings go further. And one of the ways they tried to do this was to have international agreements with other central banks wherein, for example, the Bank of England would get the Bank of France to not ask for international settlements of gold itself, but to just keep balances with the Bank of England and treat those balances as their reserve money, as their reserve currency. This was called the sterling system. And the Fed was involved, too, with countries keeping balances at the Fed but not asking for their gold. It was a little bit like the later Bretton Woods system, but more ad hoc. Well, that worked for a while. The problem was, what happens if the French change their mind, for example, and suddenly ask for all their gold back from England? And the answer is, what happens is you get the beginning of the Great Depression. And this caused the whole house of cards that was known as the gold exchange standard, what I was just describing, to collapse. And that was the proximate cause of the Great Depression. We could go into the more details, but the story is we had a jury-rigged post-World War I gold standard in place of the old classical international gold standard. It was a bit of a house of cards. It was very vulnerable to collapse because it depended heavily on central bank cooperation, that is, cooperation of different central banks. Ultimately, it did collapse. This led to a massive deflationary crisis and to the breakdown of that jury-rigged gold standard. There were various attempts afterwards to, again, try to recreate the gold standard in some aspects. The Bretton Woods system was the outcome of that after World War II. It also was not a sustainable system. It was an inherently weak system. And by the way, the collapse there was a similar story to the one in 1930. The French were now accumulating claims not against the Bank of England, but against the Fed in the 30s, in the 1960s. They again asked for their gold toward the end of that decade. They decided enough's enough, and that caused the Bretton Woods system to collapse. So that's the story of the, I know it's long, but a lot of people don't know, you know, about these details of the story of how the gold standard ended, but that is essentially the story.
And I think a lot of people have to realize that when we're talking about the Bretton Woods system and most of the international economic systems that developed after the end of World War II, It's that the United States is essentially unscathed from the war. It had blood and treasure that was clearly spent, but our manufacturing base, our industries, our infrastructure, they were not hindered, but helped because Europe and Asia were essentially destroyed and we had all these international captive markets. We also had the dollar pegged as the dominant international currency.
So we could sell the dollar as the new gold while pretending for a while that it was still a gold arrangement because, in principle, dollars were convertible into gold. But please don't actually convert them was the setup, right? The dollar, the gold is still a dollar for you central banks, but don't ask for your gold. That'll kind of spoil everything.
And at the same time, we're basically getting reparations for our involvement in the war from these countries that we asked not to redeem our gold-backed dollars for gold.
Yes, in a way. But then, of course, because of Vietnam and the Great Society, the Fed started to create lots of dollars. And so the credits of the foreign central banks started to pile up. And like bankers generally, central bankers get a little bit antsy when they start getting a lot of credits piling up, like a bank receiving a lot of checks and leaving them in its safe. At some point they say, you know, maybe we need to cash these. And that's what happened. And it was bound to happen eventually. Well, I suppose if the Fed had been very disciplined, it could have avoided it. But the other side of the story is that if you've got other countries agreeing not to cash your checks, as it were, the temptation is to write more of them, isn't it? So one way or the other, I think this system could not have lasted. It didn't last very long, and I don't think it could have lasted very long. So once the Humpty Dumpty of the old gold standard fell apart in the course of World War I, they never were able to put it back together again. And perhaps they could not possibly have done so, but they certainly failed to do so in a way that was sustainable.
Well, it's impossible to imagine the era of profligate government spending that we've had experienced over the course of the past 4 or 5 decades would have been possible under a gold standard, because there simply wouldn't have been enough gold to construct this far-reaching imperial America that we built for ourselves.
It wouldn't have been enough gold, certainly, for the Fed to have expanded as much as it did in the post-war period, but mostly in the 60s and 70s when it created all that inflation. I'm not sure that that would have been a bad thing in itself, because the inflation was a bad thing and we would have been better off with a lot less. But in any event, there wasn't enough gold to sustain the system, the price level that existed in even before the inflation, let's say the price level circa 1960, unless other central banks continued to cooperate by maintaining Fed balances instead of cashing them in. And that's the thing that couldn't reasonably have been expected to last forever. I think the bureaucrats really overestimated how much you could rely on the central banks to cooperate in a system like that. They perhaps were being idealistic, but in any event, they put their hopes in an arrangement that I don't believe could possibly have actually lasted much longer than it did.
The last topic I'd like to talk with you about is certainly no simpler than what we've been discussing. I think when you look at our current state of affairs in the global economy, the United States still holds a very significant leadership role, but has a nearly insurmountable debt crisis. I don't see a willingness for the kind of policies of austerity across all income brackets that would be needed in order to fix our balance books and pay the debt down. But we're approaching $20 trillion in debt, and that seems like a science fiction outcome from where we were at the turn of the millennium when the government operated with a short-lived budget surplus, you know, at the end of the Clinton administration. This was the last time, in my opinion, I think we really had a chance to deal with the debt. So that's bad, but when you look at the average person's living existence, when you look not just here but around the world in countries except for those that just have terribly barbarous regimes, the standard of living that people enjoy today in the fiat system is much better than it was in the aggregate when we had the classical gold standard.
They certainly have a higher standard than they had, or than the average person had under the classical gold standard. It's a great question what kind of standard of living people would have had the gold standard, the classical gold standard, somehow been kept up to this day. Very hard counterfactual to do, of course. By the way, I've seen some attempts to do it that are absolutely no good, that's consisted of taking the growth rate of the gold standard era and assuming that it would have continued until this day, which is assuming that that growth rate was entirely due to the gold standard. But, of course, it's not. It wasn't. The very rapid economic growth rate of the U.S. in the gold standard period was to an important extent due to the rapid population growth we had then. If you correct for that, then the same extrapolation suggests we wouldn't be much better off today. But you'd still be doing it wrong because a million things have changed since the 19th century. So it's very hard to say what difference a gold standard would make. I suspect that it's just a guess that the gold standard of the old-fashioned, good old gold standard, if it had somehow stayed in place, would have given us very good living standards today, because it maintained a lot of stability both domestically and importantly internationally, because you had fixed exchange rates. But it's a very difficult counterfactual to offer, and you shouldn't put much credence in what I or anyone else says about what a gold standard would have meant for us today if it stayed in place.
Is it your opinion that the neoliberal economic model has failed us and that we need to look beyond this to get the global economy's house in order? Or do you think we just have to work within our current system to correct more than half a century of bad policy?
As a matter of practical policy, Charles, of course, tweaking is about all we can do, but we can hope that we can tweak and keep tweaking and eventually move things in a more substantial way in a direction that we think is desirable. As for the policies being generally bad, or the model, as you called it, the liberal economic model, I'm not sure I would go that far. I would say I don't think it's the liberal economic model that's gone wrong. I do think that it's gone wrong to the extent that it has accepted central banks and their management of fiat monies and their discretionary management of such as the best of all monetary policy alternatives. And we've done that even though they keep failing us again and again and again. We've also accepted heavy-handed government regulation of private financial systems as the best way to deal with those and avoid crises, even though it includes things like too big to fail and other explicit and implicit guarantees that, in my opinion, and in many other economists, are the most potent source of excessive risk-taking in the financial and the private financial markets. So I think we need to get away from both of those things. As I said, I don't think a gold standard needs to be the part of that retreat, and I don't think it's the best alternative today. But I do think we should get away with excessively discretionary financial central banks, and we should get away from a system where we try to make banks behave well by getting government more and more involved in the banking system. Because remember, the big banks especially are powerful interest groups that shape government involvement in banking. It's not like the government is shaping regulations that come out in the public interest. The reality is that more often than not, these regulations end up serving the interests of the most powerful banks, even when that means undermining, in the long run, the well-being of the average citizen. We've been doing that, by the way, since as far back in this country as you can imagine. I want to point out, it's very important to point out, if you look at other countries, particularly in the past, but even to some extent in the present, you can find examples of countries that have had very stable banking systems with a lot less financial interference from their governments than we have in the U.S. The U.S. is a very poor role model for other countries. It's because it's doing a bad job itself. Yet we treat it as a role model because it's big and rich. We assume that it does everything right, including how it manages banks and money. Canada, I think, is an outstanding example of a country that both historically and recently has shown how you can do a much better job with less, that is, with less government. The Bank of Canada is much more rule-bound than the bank, than the Fed. It's much more transparent about its policies, what it's up to, what it's going to do, and all that. It's no coincidence that Canada weathered the recent financial crisis quite well. Still more fascinating is if you go back to the 19th century and some time beyond, when Canada had much less government regulation, it had the same gold dollar we had. It had none of the financial crises. It had none of the short-run financial instability. It had nice, smooth interest rates. It had interest rates that were the same all over the country, more or less. And that's because it had a banking system that, believe it or not, had hardly any regulations. A few dozen banks could branch all over the country, issue all the convertible banknotes they wanted to, more or less. No reserve requirements, no portfolio requirements, no community reinvestment and stuff like that, and no bailouts, importantly. There was no deposit insurance, and there was no central bank, no Bank of Canada as yet to rescue failing banks. If they failed, well, they'd better find the buyer, or they failed, and that was that.
Well, didn't the United States have its own free banking era?
Oh, those banks in Canada were genuinely free, right? They could branch, they could issue notes. There weren't very many of them. They had to get charters, but the rules for getting a charter were you had to have a certain amount of capital, and that was pretty much it. If you looked like you were a shady institution, the government wouldn't give you a charter, but that hardly ever happened. You had to prove that you were serious and you weren't just shysters. Now, what we had in America before the Civil War is a bunch of states created laws called free banking laws. It was the name of the laws, and it's confused everybody because people think, oh, all these places had banks that were unregulated. But that was the name was free, but they weren't free. Every one of those banks, for example, every bank created under those laws couldn't have a single branch, no branching, absolutely prohibited branch banking. Which is a big deal because that's how you have powerful, diverse, well-diversified, stable banks, and it's how they get funds where they're needed without having to, you know, go hat in hand to some correspondent, let alone a central bank. The other thing is those banks couldn't issue notes unless they secured them with bonds specified by their state regulatory authorities, which typically, included the bonds of the state government in question. It turns out, economic historians have studied this, the main cause of failures of those banks, and in some of the systems they almost all failed, was the depreciation of the securities that by law the banks were forced to have as a condition for staying in business. So the whole idea that the U.S. had free banking in the sense of genuinely free banking and that it failed is a terrible misconception that gives a bad reputation to a genuinely free banking systems, even though when you look at those, like the one in Canada and also Scotland's, which was pretty much unregulated, and the Scottish bankers were actually the models for the Canadian bankers because a lot of the Canadian bankers were of Scottish ancestry. If you look at those systems and their performance, why, it was jolly good. And it was recognized as such at the time. If you go back, you can see people in Scotland and outside, people in Canada and outside, including the U.S., saying, gosh, what a great monetary and currency system we've got here in Canada. And who says that about their currency systems now? Who says that about their banks now? Of course, nobody does. Even though governments are regulating the bejeebies out of them, they still are not anything to be all that proud of. Of course, all countries have some good banks, but they also have a lot of a bad ones. So people need to look at those experiences and understand that the U.S., in contrast, has never had good banking laws, has never had good bank regulation, not because it hasn't regulated enough, but because it's always, in some fashion, regulated too much. Those are the plain facts of the matter.
Well, thanks for clearing the air on that issue. I think for numismatists who collect what we call wildcat banknotes and busted banknotes, the landscape was littered with banks that failed, and it seems that there are quite complex reasons for this. And the general distrust for these types of note-issuing authorities led the way to our federalized monetary system that we have now.
Yeah. If they can read, there's an article by two fellows named Rolnick and Weber called the Causes of Free Bank Failures, about those so-called free banks and why they went under. It's quite eye-opening. It's one of many pieces of research that straightens out the record on that topic.
Well, George, thanks for spending time with us today. I hope we can have you back again in the future.
I'd love to do it again, Charles. As I said, it was my pleasure, and I much enjoyed your questions. They're good questions, and I like those kinds of questions. I appreciate it.
All right. Well, you have a good week, sir. If you enjoyed this podcast, please share it with your friends. And remember, you can download all 60 episodes of the CoinWeek Podcast for free from the iTunes Store. While you're there, please leave us a review. It really helps a lot. For CoinWeek, I'm Editor Charles Morgan. Until next time, happy collecting.